the Sky News website, the Australian website, a more questionable website, that will be, is that what we're talking about here?
Well, what you're viewing on the internet is not what we're interested in, and that's not what we regard.
But you'll be able to see whether I've been to that website or that website or that website.
Well, what we'll be able, what the security agencies want to know, to be retained, is the electronic address of the website that the web user is
so
visiting.
So it does tell you the website?
Well, it tells you the address of the website.
That's the website, isn't it? It tells you the what website you've been to.
Well, when you visit a website, people browse from one thing to the next, and that browsing history won't be retained or there won't be any capacity to access that.
And that was a clip of our Attorney General attempting to explain metadata. You're watching The World From Below. I'm Lizzie O'Shea.
And I'm Alexander Darling. We're now joined by our guest for the program, Dr. Suelette Dreyfus. Suelette is a technology journalist and researcher. She is based in the Department of Computing and Information Systems at the University of Melbourne, where she researches the impact digital technologies have on whistleblowing. Suelette is also the author of the 1997 cult sensation Underground, which covers the exploits of a group of hackers during the late 80s and 90s, most notably Julian Assange. Today we're discussing the federal government's data retention proposal. Polls this week revealed that 51% of Australians disapprove of the government's proposal, including 30% who strongly disapprove. Hostility among under 35s is particularly strong, with 39% saying they strongly disapprove of data retention. So, Suelette, can you give us some background to this policy and why you think it's back on the agenda at the moment?
Well, it's clearly been something that the intelligence and law enforcement community has been interested in pursuing for some time. It appeared in a government discussion paper that was floated, I think, in 2012, and it has been either implemented or explored in other countries around the globe. There is a perception among some in this area that somehow, if they get ever more masses of data, somehow they will be able to presumably predict and stop terrorist attacks and also use it to solve crimes. However, there are question marks around that.
Can you explain to us what actually is metadata? Because there's been some confusion around it, and whether it is a safeguard for people who might be concerned about privacy.
Yep. So there's been a lot of confusion about it. In part because the Prime Minister and the Attorney General had different descriptions of exactly what would be included. There is no one clear, simple description that will say what is and isn't in the catchment. But generally what you would say is it is everything except, it is all the data around the exact conversation. That's really what it is. And there are some people who say, oh, well, if you have someone's metadata, it doesn't really matter that much. It's not an invasion of their privacy. But let's put this into perspective. So the former National Security Agency of the United States Special Counsel said that if we have your metadata, we have everything we need. We know everything we need to know about you. People who do work in the area of researching data will tell you that given a choice between having a large amount of metadata and just the conversation, as opposed to any of the metadata, a good forensic analysis would often tend to make you want to get just the metadata if you had a choice. In addition to which, the former director of the NSA and the CIA said, quote, we kill people based on metadata. So that gives you an idea of how serious metadata actually is. And in fact, there was a 2012 Supreme Court ruling in the United States, which was not around metadata per se, but it was about whether or not authorities should be able to track your GPS, movement, track your movements with a GPS tracker without a warrant. And they said, no, you have to do it because of the level of invasion of someone's life. Well, if you are carrying a mobile phone, that is effectively a GPS tracker. So this will track from one mobile tower to another, what your movements are, different times of the day, how long you stay at a place, who you might call from there, how often you call them. And what this Supreme Court ruling said, it was very interesting, was that the level of invasion of personal privacy really amounted to being able to say, to track you to the visit to the words were the psychiatrist, the abortion clinic, the gay bar, the, you know, sexually transmitted disease clinic, any number of things that would otherwise be very private and personal about our lives. But you could obviously draw pretty good conclusions based on what that tracking information was.
Now, ASIO head David Irvine maintains that the collection of such data will be used to combat terrorism, and that has been put forward by the Prime Minister as a justification for this kind of data retention. To what extent do you think that's likely to be an effective strategy against terrorism, and to what extent do you feel citizens can feel safe that that's what it will be used for?
Well, so this is very interesting. It started out just for being terrorism, and as the week progressed, it became terrorism and law enforcement. A couple of data points are important to that. First of all, as we had mandatory collection of metadata from overseas, we've seen some research that's been done into the effectiveness. And does it really solve crimes? Does it stop terrorism? There was a German study in 2011 by Max Planck Institute in the criminology area, and it basically said, well, on the issue of solving crimes, we haven't seen any significant improvement in solving crimes as a result of having, you know, mandatory data retention. And not only for Germany, also for Austria, also for Switzerland. So now you have a couple of countries in Europe. In addition to which, a committee, a civil liberties oversight committee that was appointed by President Obama, also released a report in, I think it was January of 2014, which had much the same conclusion regarding no real impact on terrorism. And so we see, well, there is data to suggest that there is no real impact, and there's no data to suggest that there is impact. So that suggests that you're really reaching out there to do a very heavy-handed approach to data collection without any evidence that it actually works. There's another problem in that normally when you go after a particular target in a case where there's some evidence of criminal wrongdoing, you may, you know, get a warrant for listening to their phone, that sort of thing. You'll amass a lot of data. If you're trying to do that for 23 million Australians, instead of just looking for a needle in one haystack, you've created potentially 23 million haystacks. It's much harder to find that needle. So in fact, you're potentially making your job much harder by doing that. And the question is, well, why do you want to do that? The other element, and last element that's really important to this, is that right now authorities can get metadata by making a request without a warrant for a particular person. Now, the last figures that we have federally from Australia, which I think was 2012-13, was that there were something like 330,000 requests. That's a lot of requests. And they don't just come from intelligence agencies or even the AFP. These requests can be from the RSPCA, they can be from the ACCC, a range of agencies that while they may do quite legitimate work, one would query whether or not accessing someone's private information that, you know, the NSA and CIA have said we use this to kill people without a warrant is really appropriate.
Well, we'll be taking a short break now, and we'll be back to talk more with Dr. Suelette Dreyfus right after these messages.